that's what butterflies do. They multiply, they spread fragrance, and that's why Satan hates you. And I tell you what, he hates women, and he hates women more than men. I mean, I think he hates us all, and he does a good job of keeping men down, but he keeps us down because women are powerful. And if I don't understand who I am in Christ, I'm not going to open my mouth to talk about him. I'm not going to do the works that he's called me to do. I'm going to spend my time, instead of spreading good news, I'm going to be gossiping. Instead of loving others, I'm focused on myself. Instead of allowing him to work in me and heal me and do the work he wants to do to make me that vessel that he can use, I'm going to hold on to my bitternesses and my selfishness and my whatever it is that we all occupy ourselves with. And he's got so much more for us. We are, I believe, a hidden army sitting in our churches. Over 50% of the church is women. In fact, in many countries of the world, it's 80 to 90%. But women are sitting broken all over the world with no self-esteem. They don't know their value in Christ. They don't know that they have authority and power in the Lord. And a lot of that is because they're kept down by religious power. And I'm not talking about here that we all need to be pastors and deacons. And that's not, I'm not talking about the titles. I'm talking about, I don't mean that. So Jesus will raise me up if I will die to myself. He'll put me where he wants. We're talking about sitting with him in the heavenly places, being the women that God wants us to be, serving in power where he wants us to serve. Jennifer's got a whole and flourishing ministry. So she's a woman who stood up to do what God's called her to do. She died to herself, if you've ever heard her story. When she was here last time, she shared that. And now God's using her to be his fragrance and encourage others. To minister. Women have ability. If you tell a woman something, she's going to share it. And if you want to spread news, television, telephone, or tell a woman. Right? And that's why Satan hates your voice. He wants to close your voice down. Because women have voices. Women are nurturers. Women gather people. Women are communicators. There's every sort of reason in the world that Satan doesn't want women to get freedom. You can be a believer sitting in the church and be as dead as a doornail. You know, are you sitting here as a believer, you're a hidden butterfly living like a caterpillar? Because if you know Jesus, your Savior, the Holy Spirit is in you. He just needs to come alive so everybody else can see it. You've got wings. But you know what? There's some stuff going on inside us. Like Sue said, there are roots in us that keep us down. Whether it's low self-esteem, or whether it's busyness, or whether it's woundedness, it may not be any of that. It may just be life. You just haven't ever been awakened to the fact that there is a life that you can live that's in power. So I want you to turn to your books in these closing moments. We are going to be wrapping up the year, but this is probably the most important part of the day. You turn to page 5. On page 5, the top of that page, it says, make me usable. You've heard the song, if you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. But the evangelist Reinhard Bonnke suggests a more powerful prayer, which is, Lord, make me usable. What we've been talking about today is, Lord, make me usable. He can use anything, but I want to be usable in what he's prepared for me. And making me usable means a lot of surrendering and death, and because it's as I'm poured out as a drink offering for others that I'll be used. And that journey's never going to finish until I get to heaven. The journey of glory to glory is one that I'm going to be on. But I wrote something here. When God is calling us, where God is calling us to minister, according to, I'm talking about ministry, Isaiah 61 ministry. I'm talking about Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted, to spread the good news, to set the captives free, to break the bondages in other people's lives, to help them experience deliverance and freedom. That kind of ministry is entering into the deep lostness, deception, bondage, wounding, and brokenness of women's hearts. It cannot be reached in our own strength or with noble desires, programs, or tools. We need a fresh invasion of the Spirit and truth to fill our own hearts and minds, transforming us so that we can be vessels he can use to break the strongholds, heal broken hearts, and set captives free. I read this somewhere. Those who are actively involved in the deliverance of souls from the bondage of Satan will never go for long without themselves being attacked But those who are to be of real spiritual help to others must be prepared for peculiar trials and tests, that the qualities of endurance and adherence to sympathy and understanding may be first wrought out in them. The attacks, if we let them, the attacks will destroy us, will defeat us. But if you will allow the attack to bring you to Jesus, to come to the foot of the cross and say, Jesus, help me, change me, I can't do this in my strength, he will raise you up. Just see, Jesus was attacked by Satan and Satan thought he got him. He thought he had Jesus right there. And he says, put extra stones over that tomb, don't let him out. Put extra guards over that tomb, don't let him out. And they thought they'd got him. Done. That's it, finished. But God sent an angel, knocked that stone out of the way, went rolling down the hill, and the angel was sitting on it. I'm like, really? You think that you can stand on Jesus, the Son of God? And today, that's what God's saying to us. He says, you think I'm going to let that monster destroy my daughters? He might think he's got his foot on you right now, but if you'll trust me, if you'll hang on through this, you watch what I'm going to do in your life. You know what? It can start right now. It can start today. God wants to remove the stones. He wants to bring healing. He wants to bring deliverance. He wants to give you more power. You might be in a really good place and say, Lord, I'm waiting. I don't know what it is you're doing in my life. I'm excited. Or maybe he wants to be a fresh filling of his spirit. Because one time is not enough. We need to be empowered by his spirit every single day. How do I receive his spirit? How did you get that baptism of the Spirit? Same way you got salvation, by faith. You ask for it. Jesus said, ask for it. And he will fill you. And there will be rivers. And he says, be thirsty. John 7. Those who come thirsty, he will fill with rivers of living water, which is the Holy Spirit. Are you thirsty? Asking the Lord to make me usable is far more dangerous than praying to be used. Praying to be used focuses on others. Praying make me usable invites the Holy Spirit's intervention to change me and transform me, empower me, conform me to the image of his will. It's much more painful. Use me, I can go out, and there's a lot of glory. I did that for years, a lot of glory. It was good, it was great, it was exciting. Felt good to go on the mission field and do all that stuff, you know. And then when you start seeing maybe usable, oh man, that's a whole different level. Now you're in the river and your feet aren't touching the ground. Now you're in territory that's uncharted. Now you're in what Eileen's talking about. There's all sorts of stuff. It's absolutely walking by faith and not by sight. You don't know what's going to happen. It's incredibly exciting. It's incredibly painful. It's incredibly awful. It's like the cross. It's terrible and wonderful all at the same time. That's the journey, the spirit-filled life of people who are truly being made usable for God. It's awful and it's wonderful. And we can choose to step into it. Becoming usable involves pain, a process of surrender, brokenness, and death, molding and reshaping to become yielded to the Holy Spirit. There's some notes there that you can take home with you on page 6, some thoughts for people. What is brokenness? A lot of us in the church don't like the word brokenness. As I said, we think brokenness is for the people that live under the bus shelters and are homeless. Brokenness is something that will come to all of us at some point in our lives, and we should be able to say thank you for it. Brokenness brings me to the end of myself halfway through the page. It says, so that I can live freely for God. Brokenness delivers me from my need for glory to become a woman who brings God glory. There's the thing right there. It's not about my glory, it's about bringing God glory. Brokenness opens the doors to freedom. As I'm emptied in brokenness, it allows a deeper invasion of God's Spirit. And here's a question for us. What is freedom? I read this again in my journal. John Ogilvie writes, freedom is an emancipated, fearless condition of our minds, which is expressed in our personalities and feelings about ourselves, others, life's challenges and opportunities, and our expectations for what the future holds. It's a freedom in our minds, a fearless condition. Not afraid of anyone or the future. Do you live in that freedom? Freedom from bondage? Top of page 7, freedom is found in an intimate relationship with God. It's based on knowledge of who he is, his love and purpose towards us, and trusting him completely with every aspect of our lives. To know God is to love him, to love God know I'm loved is to trust Him. To trust God is to live in freedom. Freedom empowers me to love and serve unconditionally, knowing I'm freely loved. How do we lose our freedom? Whenever anything blocks the free flowing of the Holy Spirit in our lives, I think Sharina talked about that. Holy Spirit couldn't work. She was a butterfly that was lying on the ground with crushed wings. There's many, many women out there, and men with crushed wings, lying on the ground, no power, don't know how to access it. Freedom is found in brokenness. Freedom found in brokenness brings greater intimacy and dependency on Him. That's the key right there. Freedom is all about a more intimate relationship with Jesus. It's not just trying to be busy doing God's work, and all I think about is, you know, trying to fulfill the word of God through the knowledge of what's in my head. It's saying, I love Him. I'm serving Him out of love, not out of fear or performance. That's bondage. That becomes religious spirit. It's, I'm serving because I love Him. And you know what? If I don't show up or it goes wrong or I fail and it doesn't work, I'm loved. And He knows I did my best. I'm operating out of a loving heart, not out of a fear that I need to please Him. And we do want to please Him, but we do it because we love Him, not because we're afraid of Him. Freedom delivers me from self-sufficiency, control, and fear. Freedom allows me to trust in God's power alone and His ability to lead me as I yield to Him. Freedom is realizing I need Jesus Himself even more than I need His help to accomplish His work. I need Jesus more than I need His help to accomplish His work. I need Him. See, we're often very much about what we want to do for Jesus, and He's saying, I just want you to want me. The doing will come out of that. But if you spend time with me, if you want me, if you'll just be intimate with me, you're going to hear what I want you to do. I'm going to empower you to do it. Freedom delivers me to love and serve others with His divine love unconditionally, knowing that I am freely loved. So here's the question tonight for you. So now we send it back to you. I've been doing a lot of talking about you this afternoon and this morning, and others have shared. What's the Lord been saying to you? What's the Holy Spirit saying to you today of all the things we've talked about? What do you need to be set free in? What's your fear? What's your bondage? What's stopping you get off the ground and fly? And I'm not talking about doing ministry. I'm just talking about being living freely in your space, being free with who you are, free to be who God knows that you are. How are you looking in the mirror this afternoon? Has it changed any since this morning? The thing that you saw in the mirror, is that the thing that's keeping you in bondage? Your value? I want you to just take a moment and say, what do I need to be set free in? As you're doing that, if you turn over the page, this may help you to think about your freedom. The exchange is whose voice is loudest in your life. See, Satan's voice wants to take us back to Sinai, which is the old covenant. The old covenant brings judgment, condemnation, and bondage to believers. But the Holy Spirit wants to take you to Calvary. Because at Calvary, you find forgiveness and freedom. So if you are continuously feeling condemnation and bondage, you're living under an old covenant. And Jesus gives us a new covenant. And a way you can know that is to know whose voice am I listening to. I've got some lists of words here from a book called Choosing God's Best. God's voice stills you, leads you, reassures you, enlightens you, encourages you, comforts you, calms you, convicts you. There's nothing pressurizing about God's voice. But Satan's voice rushes you, pushes you, frightens you, confuses you, discourages you, worries you, obsesses you. Do you identify with any of that? Want to learn to walk in the Spirit, understand which voice you're listening to. Satan's voice will push you and drive you and pressurize you and be putting pressure on you. You're like, I can't breathe. I know I'm going to do this because they're putting pressure on me. Well, the Lord doesn't work through pressure. He's given us free will. If you're under pressure, you need to go, I need to go away and pray about this. I don't feel like, I'm not sure this is the Lord's will. I'm talking about the difference between challenging, being challenged, and being pressurized. Sometimes the Lord will challenge us, but he convicts us. He doesn't pressurize us. He doesn't condemn us. He convicts. That's different. Conviction brings me to my knees saying, yes, Lord. Condemnation just makes me go into shame. You look at the very back page, the inside back page. There's a carrot there. Sue was talking about roots. And I'm going to ask the girls to come up, the worship team, if you would, and just play something maybe for us, Rachel, slowly. And then we're going to have some time of just asking the Lord to speak to us. On this carrot, it gives an example of the things that are above the ground that are the fruit of things that are going below the ground. Sometimes the things that we see above the ground are behavior patterns that in the West will medicate them. You go to the doctor and get a pill for it because the behavior's out of control. In the East, they'll send you to meditation. But the Holy Spirit wants to take us deeper and say, I want to get inside of that behavior. I want to get inside of the root. Like Sue had to go to the dentist and get into the root. The dentist, she couldn't do it herself. She took medication to try and dull the pain. I've been there this recent few weeks. It doesn't last. It's like a temporary fix. I take the pain medication. But when the pain medication wears off, I'm still hurting. The poison is still there. I need to go to the doctor and get surgery. And so we come to the doctor and we say, shine your light and your truth, Lord. Why have I got some pain showing in my life? You might recognize these behaviors in yourself or in others. Sickness, physical and emotional sickness, addictions, anger, pride, bitterness, self-pity, self-hatred, depression, constant sinful behaviors, fears. There's other behaviors that you could add on this list. That we could say they're the top, they're the output, the symptoms. But we need to get to the cause. The Holy Spirit wants to get to the cause. And he says to us, is it sin? He's going to show us, is there sin in my life that I need to repent of? Is it a soul tie? Is there a generational connection of a pattern in your family that has come down and it's a literal demonic stronghold in your family that needs to be broken? That's where we need the power of God to break those things. Break the chains of soul ties. God has given the power to do that through Jesus Christ. Bondages, fears, things that are keeping us in a place of not being free to who God made us to be. What about lies? What are the lies that Satan has been speaking to you about? Your identity, your purpose, how God loves you. The biggest lie he wants to tell us is that God doesn't care. God's forgotten about. Or that we can handle this ourselves in our own strength. That's a great lie. That's what New Ages do. We got this. I've just got to go to my inner self. No, you haven't. You've got to kill yourself and get on your knees to Jesus. Surrender them. Ask him to reveal the lies. If you've got a damaged soul, that means your heart's broken. Or maybe your mind, just the thoughts that have been damaged in the way you think about things. Your perspective that's got sickness in it. You've got involved in the occult or in some false practice or you've touched something that you shouldn't have done and it's affected your spirit. You can have a damaged spirit by touching those things. If you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you're possessed by the Holy Spirit. You cannot be demon-possessed, but you can certainly be oppressed and demonized and have an area of your life that you're continuously falling into sin or continuously being defeated. Maybe there's things that are happening continuously in your family's life and you just think, why do we never get free of this stuff? Maybe there's a harassing spirit that you need delivered from, that we need to pray to break those things in your life and over your family. Some of the causes of a damaged spirit and soul can come from an ungodly spirit that's entered the house or entered the family and taken a hold. You've given him permission. He's had legal right. If I hold unforgiveness, I am giving Satan a legal right to keep me in bondage because it's a sin against God. It doesn't matter how much I've been hurt. It doesn't matter how much pain I've gone through. I may have been the victim and the other person's wrong, but God says, I cannot forgive you if you don't forgive others. He can't. It's not in his character because he's a God of forgiveness. rests on the forgiveness of God through Jesus Christ. So how, as I, one of his followers, can hold unforgiveness towards somebody else when he's forgiven me so much? Can't do it. It'll keep you in bondage for years. Lack of nurture that God intends. Maybe you weren't nurtured as a child. Maybe you've not had that inner relationship with a spouse or with even a friend. You just feel like you're not loved. Is it rejection? Is the biggest spirit that any of us deal with is rejection. From all sorts of areas of our lives. Pronouncing to curses, words that have been spoken over you. Words that have hurt you, crushed you, that have defined who you are. That have made your identity what it is today. Is it truth or is it lies? Jesus wants to take those off you. He's come to break the curse and replace it with truth. What about human expectations? Are you tired of living up to what other people think you should be doing? A mother, a father, a church, a job, a husband? Just like, I can't do it anymore. Are you caught up in the spirit of people pleasing? What about abuse, sexual abuse, emotional abuse, physical abuse, mental abuse? All sorts of kinds of abuse that can come against us, that's wounded us and hurt us. Accident or trauma. Something that just traumatized you and it stops you wanting to have freedom to go out and drive again or get on a plane or go into and be with people because you've had such a deep trauma that you don't want to be around other people anymore. Loss. Loss can keep us in a place of fear of losing other things. You lose your job, you're afraid you're going to lose something else. You lose a child or a husband, you're afraid what's the next thing going to be. Dreams can come of death. And we get caught up in this root of loss in us, a spirit that holds us in fear, bereavement. Unnecessarily long bereavement, because we can't get free of it. We just can't shake the spirit from our soul and our inner being. And then there's our own sin. These are the main, the generalized areas that most people, most humans, are kept in bondage with, are kept in a place of not flying, deep wounding that goes beyond what we can see with the human eye, and goes deep into the soul. I felt disregarded and devalued. How many of you feel like that as women? It happens all the time. I had to bring that to the Lord, forgive those who had hurt me, confess that apparently, Lord, I thought I'd got over this, but you know what? The enemy's always going to come and tempt us with something. He, the more you get into this battle, the more you want to rise above, the more he's going to come at you with something else. But the faster you can learn how to get out of it, once you know the path to healing, forgiveness, and freedom, you'll trip. But God says you'll stumble, but you won't fall, because he's got you. But you've got to surrender to admit you cannot do this in your own strength. God wants to heal some of your teeth. Would you come up, Kathy and Caroline? We're going to sing, they're going to lead us in a worship song right now, and I just want to give us a few moments here to ask the Holy Spirit to minister into your heart of anything that was on that list, to ask him to shine his light and truth and reveal to you, nobody's going to know about this, but to reveal to you what is in your heart that you need to get freedom and healing from. Worship song, where I'm going to invite you, those of you, all of you, I mean really, you want a divine exchange experience, whatever it is, whether you're in a good place or a bad place, or you don't know where you're heading to a place, there is nothing like stepping out and saying, Lord, I come and I yield myself to you. I want that exchange of my life. I want to give up this thing. I want you to take it. I don't have the strength to deal with it, but I'm surrendering to death. I'm surrendering my life to you. I'm not just surrendering my life. We say that, but I'm surrendering the issue, the thing that I'm holding on to. I'm surrendering the pain of it. He'll take care of the person that's hurt me. He just wants us to be obedient to surrendering whatever is keeping me bound. Generational strongholds in your family, think things that have gone down the line, we need to pray to break them. They need to be broken in the name of Jesus. You want to do that? You take a meaningful step forward. You come down here and you say, Jesus, I recognize you're the only one with power to defeat this issue in my life. Unnatural fears and anxieties, phobias, sicknesses, angers, all of those things. Bring them to the altar. And let's ask the God who sent his power to raise Jesus from the dead to do some miraculous work in our lives. Why? So that we can go out and give him the glory. The reason we're saying this is so that we can see God's people set free, so the stumbling blocks are removed, and we can go out there and move in power because of the testimony of what he's done. Because we're called to be ministers and witnesses, and I can't be a minister or a witness unless I've got something that I've witnessed in my life. I need to have experienced his power, his divine exchange in my own life. Like the woman at the well that got completely turned around and goes and brings her whole village back to Jesus. That's what we want. Imagine if we had these 70 women in the room here who have a divine exchange experience today with Jesus, where the Holy Spirit just comes into your life in power, and you're out that door and the whole of Avalon is going to know about it. 70 women would turn Avalon upside down. And I have faith that's going to happen. We'll change our churches. We'll change our families. You have influence, women. You have influence, more influence than you think. Satan's trying to take that from you. He's trying to snatch it. You've got to believe that God has a plan for you. Let's pray. Father, I ask you to take whatever you have provided through the word today that you've spoken through all of us, through the worship, through the fellowship, through the testimonies and the word that you've shared. I'm asking you now to allow your Holy Spirit, release your Holy Spirit in this place, to shine your light and truth and open the eyes of our hearts, Lord, to see what's in our lives that we just need to be set free from. This is our opportunity today, Lord. You want us to fly higher. You're calling us higher to glory, to glory. If somebody just needs encouragement, Lord, in the middle of their Saturday, ask that you would just be pouring your Holy Spirit out on them in divine love. For those who need chains broken, oh God, I ask in the name of Jesus, break the chains that are keeping my sisters bound, Lord. The fears, the angers, the hurts, and the wounds. Generational curses, we break them off in the name of Jesus. We break them off in the name of Jesus. Lord, this is the victory, this is overcome the world, even our faith. It's as we take a step of faith, oh God, and I open this altar up now, Lord, so that we can exercise our faith and say that we will not be defeated by Satan. And we don't have the power to defeat him, Lord Jesus, but you have already defeated him. He's lost. We are not fighting for victory. We are fighting from victory. So God, I ask you, my Father, today, by the same power that you raised Jesus from the dead, would you send that power from heaven this afternoon, Holy Spirit, and flood our hearts. Flood this room with your power. Send your Holy Ghost power in this place, Lord. Send your power to transform our lives, to set us free. If there's anyone here who has never received forgiveness of their sins and had a reception of the Holy Spirit come into their lives and change them because of the blood of Jesus, I invite you to come down here to the front and speak to me. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you're going to do here. In Jesus' name, invite others to come and join Lisa here at the altar.